Okay. So the next subheading is treatment. The presenting situation of the patient is that they have lost a lot of salt and water from their body fluids, okay, in the form of diarrhea, and in severe cases they also vomit, and that collectively puts the patient into a dehydrated condition, right? And dehydration leads to weakness, alright? Then collectively all these water electrolyte loss in the form of motions, that is diarrhea, or sometimes even in severe cases you vomit, so that collectively takes the patient into a dehydrated state, which is shown by weakness, right? So the treatment for such patients is, number one, taking ORT, that is oral rehydration therapy, in the form of ORS, in the form of ORS, oral rehydrating supplements. Okay? We try to manage the dehydrated state of the patient by giving them oral rehydration therapy in the form of supplements, oral rehydrating supplements, and those supplements are jo aap normally ORS dete hain. Ek word ORS aapne suna hai, bahut commonly use hota hai. So that's basically salt and sugar, that is in the form of a powder that you mix in water, okay? You empty the entire sachet into a jug of water and you advise that patient to drink water from the jug, right? That is, the patient is orally trying to rehydrate themselves by taking salt and glucose supplements mixed with water. So that kind of balances the electrolytes which are lost, the ions, and it also balances the water which is lost from the body. Okay, but if the patient is very, very severely sick, dehydrated, and sometimes in the very severe stages of cholera, they are also vomiting. So you can't give them anything orally, right? So then you have to treat them through the intravenous therapy. That is giving them drips, as you commonly know, okay, in the form of drips. If the patient is very severely sick and they cannot tolerate anything orally and they are vomiting constantly, then you give them, obviously you can't leave them, they will die in such a situation, then you start administering drips, okay? And we always go for intravenous therapy. Now we know that drips could also be given in the artery, they could also be intra-arterial, okay? They can also be intra-arterial, but we do not give drips in the artery. We give drips in the veins. Okay? For two reasons. Sabse pehli baat ye, the arteries have a very tremendous pressure of blood within them. They have blood flowing under high pressure. So when you puncture the artery, the blood loss is to a greater extent. Okay? This tremendous blood loss, there's tremendous chances of blood loss because arteries are carrying blood under pressure, and we did that in the cardiac system when we were doing transport in mammals, right? Uske baad, second point, arteries are slightly deeply embedded in your muscles, right? So you have to go a little deeper to prick them, and that causes a lot of pain. Arteries are deeply embedded in the muscles, they're not as superficial as you can see the veins, right? So to be able to reach them, to prick them, considerably more painful. Okay? And the third reason is arteries have thicker walls. Again, you know that we did the wall structure of the artery versus the wall structure of the vein. So you understand very well that the wall of the artery is thicker as compared to the vein. So it's considerably difficult to prick and puncture the artery, which is why we always go for intravenous therapy. That is, we prefer to administer drips in the veins, right? And again, what we are administering in the vein is sodium chloride drips, okay? Saline solutions, drinker solutions, they are mixed with sodium chloride and glucose in water. That is again to balance whatever has been lost from the intestinal cells. Aap samajh ke baad? Alright, uske baad hum baat karenge. What happens in the treatment? Okay? What actually happens when you are giving, when you are rehydrating? Again, we will refer to the same diagram. Okay? Okay, so this is the capillary again. This is your intestinal cell. The microvilli and the villi. Okay? And this is the lumen. Okay? First of all, what happens is sodium pump. Point number one. So when you are doing the sodium potassium pump, I told you that sodium potassium pump, the greatest amount of energy in the body is utilized by the sodium potassium pump, and the pump is always pumping out 3 sodium ions and it is replacing 2 potassium ions. We did this in chapter 4. Okay? Transport across membranes, we have studied the working of the sodium potassium pump as an example of active transport, right? And I said that it is the active transport in terms of sodium potassium pump that creates an intracellular negative environment. Isliye ki every time the pump is pumping 3 sodium ions, that is taking out 3 positive charges, bringing in 2 positive charges in terms of potassium, creates a deficit of negative 1. Okay? It creates a deficit of negative 1, and when there are so many pumps all across the membrane, okay, they collectively produce an intracellular negative environment. Now that intracellular negative environment, point number 2, एक तो ये कि इंट्रासेल्युलर नेगेटिव एनवायरनमेंट है, दूसरा ये कि द सोडियम कॉन्सेंट्रेशन इन द सेल इज लो, ठीक है? सो इट्स एन इलेक्ट्रोकेमिकल ग्रेडियंट दैट इज एस्टैब्लिश्ड. इलेक्ट्रो बिकॉज ऑफ द चार्जेस, केमिकल ग्रेडियंट बिकॉज देयर इज लेस पॉजिटिव चार्जेस इनसाइड, लेस सोडियम इनसाइड, मोर सोडियम आउट. सो दैट कॉजेस द सोडियम टू फ्लो फ्रॉम द लूमन, दैट इज द सोडियम दैट यू जस्ट टेकन इन द फॉर्म ऑफ ORS supplement that you just drank, right, or you just gave to the patient. So sodium goes in. Along with sodium, point number 3 is glucose. Abhi aap wali diagram banaye, 1, 2, 3 likhenge aur main aapko explain karungi har point pe, dictated note likhwaungi, theek hai? Sodium ke saath glucose goes as an example of co-transport. So now we have glucose with a lot of sodium. This glucose is facilitatively diffused, point number 4, onto the blood side. When sodium and glucose, a lot of ions also follow from the supplement. And then this increases the solute potential, 5. This increases the solute potential and osmosis of water takes place. And the osmosis of water takes place. So that is how the supplements work. That is how the ORT, the oral supplements work. ठीक है, अब आप ये diagram जब बना लेंगे, point number 1, 2, 3. 4, 5, 6 लिखेंगे. अब इनके बारे में वी राइट डाउन इन डिटेल, ठीक है, एज टू व्हाट इज हैपनिंग इन प्लेस ऑफ पॉइंट 1. Alright. So you write down for point one that sodium is actively pumped out. Sodium is actively pumped out using ATP. Sodium is actually pumped out using ATP from the intestinal cells to the extracellular places, fluid. From the intestinal cells into the, ये है ना सारा extracellular fluid जो बाहर है, ECF, और ये ICF है, intracellular fluid है. So sodium ions are actively pumped out, ठीक है? जब actively बोलते हैं तो उसका मतलब है using energy. Into the extracellular fluid. Point number two, the pumping of sodium out of the intestinal cells decreases the sodium's concentration inside. Decreases the sodium concentration inside and also creates an intracellular negative environment. And also creates an intracellular negative environment. Yeah? That becomes the driving force for sodium to flow from the lumen into the cell. The electrochemical gradient for sodium causes sodium to flow from the lumen into the cell. Okay? Then point number three, as sodium goes along, it takes glucose with itself. As sodium flows into the cell, it takes glucose along with it. ठीक है, सोडियम ड्राइव्स द प्रोसेस एंड ग्लूकोज एंटर्स अगेंस्ट द कॉन्सेंट्रेशन ग्रेडियंट को ट्रांसपोर्ट एक्टिव ट्रांसपोर्ट सेकेंडरी एक्टिव ट्रांसपोर्ट सोडियम ड्राइव्स द प्रोसेस एंड ग्लूकोज एंटर्स अगेंस्ट द कॉन्सेंट्रेशन ग्रेडियंट as part of a co-transport mechanism, as part of a co-transport mechanism, which is also called secondary active transport. We did this in phloem. Sucrose was being co-transported with hydrogen ions when we did the chapter transported plants, right? There we did co-transport of sucrose with hydrogen, active loading of sucrose. Samantali, there sucrose was being transported with hydrogen ions, and here we have glucose being transported with sodium ions. So this is also an example of secondary active transport. ठीक है? उसके बाद हम लिखेंगे glucose from within the cells facilitatedly diffuses into the blood. Again, I'm using the word facilitated diffusion. You know that glucose cannot be carried by diffusion. It's large. It's charged. So it needs to be carried and transported by carrier proteins, which is why we are using the word facilitated diffusion. So point number four is glucose is facilitatedly diffused into the blood. ठीक है? उसके बाद point number five में हम लिखेंगे sodium and glucose concentration within the cell becomes a driving force for other ions also to pass from the lumen into the cells. Sodium and glucose concentration within the cell becomes a driving force for the transport of other ions such as chloride, magnesium and potassium also to travel within the cell from the lumen. Okay? With all these ions inside the intestinal cell with glucose and with sodium, the solute potential becomes high within the cell and it becomes a driving force for water to pass into the cells due to osmosis. It becomes a driving force for water to pass into the cells through osmosis. ठीक है? So this is how the oral rehydration supplements work. When you take sodium chloride and glucose dissolved in water, this is the mechanism of the treatment. As to this is how it helps. ठीक है? Okay. उसके बाद हम लिखेंगे हमारी next heading हो जाएगी after treatment. Factors leading to the spread of cholera. ठीक है, उसके बाद हमारी next heading हो जाएगी factors leading to the spread factors leading to the spread of cholera. Okay, so you write down poor sanitation. If the fecal waste is not disposed properly, that's what you mean by poor sanitation. Number two, contamination of drinking water. Number two, contamination of drinking water. Number three, poor living conditions, overcrowding, refugee situation, you know. Number four, poor hygiene. Number five, lack of awareness regarding transmission of cholera. That is illiterate, uneducated environment. Lack of awareness regarding transmission of cholera. Then number six, natural disasters. Number seven, bulk of mobile people, that is refugees. Bulk of mobile people, that is refugees. People migrating from one place to the other. Point number eight, lack of water purification treatment plants. Lack of water purification treatment plants. Point number nine, no proper medical assistance provided at the time of need. No proper medical assistance provided at the time of need. Point number 10, no effective vaccine. We'll discuss why vaccines don't work. Number 11, if the immune system is very weak or not effective. If the immune system is very weak or not effective. It can be weak in areas where there are a lot of deficiencies and malnourishment, like the third world countries, and the immune system is not well developed. Okay? It can also be ineffective if you already are suffering from an underlying disorder. For example, you already have tuberculosis, you have AIDS, you have a cancer of some region. So your immune system is not effective. It is already compromised on the situation that the body is facing, and it is not working anymore. So in such cases also, that is, it's one of the leading factors. Okay? Uske baad point number 12, using sewage water for irrigating vegetables and crops. Using sewage water for irrigating vegetables and crops. Sadly, hamare mulk mein bahut hota hai ye. Especially Malir mein, pure jo wo pura, they call it what, gutter bagiche ka. You know, vegetables grown out of water, when they are being irrigated by the sewage water. So a lot of vegetables are grown. So that is also one of the factors which leads to poor health and cholera. Okay? Uske baad then, we have the next heading is why vaccinations fail. Why vaccination fails. Why vaccination fails to eradicate. ठीक है? Okay, इसके लिए हम लिखेंगे, the transmission cycle of cholera is difficult to break. The transmission cycle of cholera is difficult to break. ठीक है? Number two, difficulty vaccinating people when they are displaced from their homes. That is, it's not possible to vaccinate a lot of people in a refugee camp or a refugee-like situation. You know, when they are bulks grouped under one roof. Difficulty vaccinating people when they are displaced from their homes. Then vaccination also fails when people have poor diet and a poor immune system. Again, third world country situation. Poor diet and a poor immune system. Point number four, vaccines only provide a short-term protection. A lot of concepts you just write down for now, because they will be more clear when we do when you're doing the next chapter, the last chapters, right? So a lot of concepts that you might, you know, don't understand now, but you will after I've done the next chapter, because these two chapters are very closely related in a lot of terms. Okay, so vaccines provide short-term protection because a lot of booster doses are needed. Okay, then the strain that causes cholera mutates very often. Which is why the pharmaceutical companies are always at war against the outbreak of so many infections. Because, you know, 1 year they make a medicine or an antibiotic related to a certain strain, and the next year the strain mutates. So then they are left behind, because the medicine that they formed the year before is not going to be effective now when the strain has mutated. So which is why there is constant war against bacteria and the pharmaceutical companies, right? The strain that causes cholera mutates very often. Uske baad, antigenic concealment. When the bacteria hides inside the body cells and tissues. ठीक है, लाइक ट्यूबरक्यूलोसिस, बैक्टीरिया हाइड्स इनसाइड द लंग्स. कॉलरा, बैक्टीरिया हाइड्स इनसाइड द इंटेस्टाइनल सेल्स. सो इट बिकम्स डिफिकल्ट फॉर द मेडिकेशन टू रीच. ओके, देन लास्ट पॉइंट इज वैक्सीनेशन नॉट डिस्पर्स्ड एंड यूज्ड प्रॉपरली बाय द हेल्थ अथॉरिटीज. व्हेन वैक्सीनेशन इज नॉट प्रॉपरली यूज्ड and dispensed by the health authorities. Again, it's a problem related to the third world countries. Sometimes vaccines have an expensive mode of delivery. They require expensive material to be put into people, right? Equipment is not very cost friendly. Or when the vaccine needs to be kept at a certain temperature, maintained at a certain temperature. So, you know, carrying that vaccination to far away places, and maintaining the temperature at the same time becomes a problem. So these are the problems collectively faced by a disease where vaccination fails. ठीक है? उसके बाद then we have prevention of cholera. Prevention of cholera, जो भी इसके factors leading to है उनको उल्टा करने तो prevention हो जाएगा. Washing hands, washing utensils, medical awareness, you know, educate people. Do not irrigate the vegetable and the crops by the sewage water, proper disposal of sewage. So sare leading factors ko jab hum opposite kar denge to wo prevention ho jayega uska. Theek hai? And now just last heading, which is going to be the strains of cholera. The last subheading, which is the strains of cholera, the different strains of cholera. Okay, the different strains so far. Strain number one is called, iska naam hai Strain 01. ठीक है, अब इसके बारे में हम लिखेंगे. It originated in Bangladesh and it has caused six pandemics from 1817 till 1923. This strain was originated in Bangladesh. It has caused six pandemics from 1817 to 1923. उसके बाद second is the strain called L-Tor. Second strain is called L-Tor. And it caused the seventh pandemic, originated in Indonesia and it caused the seventh pandemic. Then the third stream is strain 0139. Strain 0139 It has caused the AIDS pandemic and is regarded as the most virulent. It has caused the AIDS pandemic and is regarded as the most virulent, very, very strong. Okay? And it has been the most virulent strain till now. So these are the different strains, and because I just said that there are different strains, they mutate from time to time, which is why it becomes difficult to control cholera, okay? Which is why vaccinations also largely fail. So with this we finish the topic on cholera. The worksheets that I posted on the group, worksheet 1 relates to all the questions, that is MCQ paper 1 based questions, and paper 2, which is structured questions, all questions which are based on cholera. So I would advise that you do your worksheets as I go along in my teaching. So your homework after this is to complete your worksheet 1, which is all based on cholera.